Kia ora, Fleur. Thank you so much for joining us to discuss the state of sustainable finance. Could we start with you just introducing yourself and Good Shepherd?
Kia ora. So thank you for having me. I'm Fleur Howard, the Chief Executive of Good Shepherd New Zealand. We're a charitable organisation established in 2012 to continue the work of the Good Shepherd Sisters in New Zealand. We're part of a global network spanning more than 70 countries. Our purpose is to tackle the significant issues impacting women, girls and whānau. And that means that we work in areas where women and girls are overrepresented in negative outcomes, like financial and economic wellbeing. Broadly, our three strategic goals for the next 5 years are to build financial wellbeing. And that's by building our existing microfinance and debt solutions programs, Good Loans and Debt Solve, and focusing on financial security and resilience for women, girls and their families. The second one is to advance social wellbeing, and that's by identifying social issues where we can contribute the value of our expertise with a focus on the intersection of financial and economic wellbeing with other social issues. Third one is to influence systems change, and that's by advocating for changes in policies and practices to reduce and remove barriers to financial inclusion and economic participation.
Now, you mentioned financial inclusion. That was actually one of the areas in the Sustainable Finance Forum roadmap. So there's one recommendation in particular, and that was to recognise that financial services and products are a utility, just like power and water, and to create an inclusive financial system. One of the specific actions in this theme is to provide support for innovative impact products and services targeted at underserved groups. Can you just speak to this recommendation? What's your take on it?
Well, for us, financial inclusion means that people have access to appropriate and affordable products and services, and that they have the knowledge and the confidence to make informed financial decisions. So it's kind of our language. In the past, and still to some extent today, our society has assumed that people lack knowledge, and so people facing financial difficulties were just sent off to budgeting services. The reality is that many people are great at budgeting, but they're excluded from the appropriate products, so that speaks to the recommendation. You can be the best budgeter in the world, but if your only option is a high-cost payday loan because no one else or lend to you because you've got a bad credit score, you have to make high repayments, and that's the road to financial hardship. So almost everyone experiences hardship or a life event that impacts their financial situation at some stage, and we just think that people need a range of products that they can access, and services as well, over the course of their lifetime to make sure that they can get back on their feet after those events.
And what kind of difference could it make if we did have those products and if we did lift financial inclusion? How different would life look?
It would look much better. People would lead more fulfilling lives and reach their potential, and it would probably save us a fortune as a country as well. So we kind of, at the moment, we pick up the pieces of people's financial hardship or desperation in all sorts of ways. Financial hardship creates untold levels of stress, poor physical, mental health, and we spend a lot of money on health and have poor health outcomes in this country, and we know that that's compounded by financial pressure. I think we also pay for our exclusive, you know, our current exclusive financial system at the moment, and transfers from MSD to families who don't have money for food and power, or when people are driven to crime because they can't see a way out of their situation. So it would make a huge difference.
So can you outline some developments that you're aware of in this area in the past 12 to 18 months?
I feel like we're heading in the right direction. I've seen some over the course of my time in this work, some really positive steps towards change. More people and more organisations are becoming aware of the need for change, but I would say that we're still only scratching the surface. So for us, for Good Shepherd, we've extended our drive insurance pilot with Suncorp, and that's been a great example of taking a fresh look at why people aren't insuring their cars and listening to them to develop something appropriate. We've also improved our Good Loans program that we run with BNZ by making all of our loans no interest for things like secondhand cars, to get to work, devices, and even up to $15,000 to address unmanageable debt. So that's all interest-free now. And another cool development for us is extending those loans to meet the needs of victims of family violence. Often we're seeing that people earn too much on paper to receive government support, but the reality of the family violence means that they're being prevented from accessing that money so to meet their essential needs. So, you know, constant incremental changes. There are other people doing some really awesome work as well out there, but we need to all be doing more.
So what's holding back progress in this area?
A nice language, I think a lack of understanding of the realities of other people's lives. So for way too long, we've said financial education or budgeting classes will help people out of their financial hardship, but that's such a tiny, tiny piece of the puzzle. Unfortunately, it's an easy way to project the issue onto those people who are already struggling, rather than take up the challenge of educating ourselves better about their realities and what we can do to support those. I think people need access to what they need at the right time. So at the moment, people don't have genuine choices and they're constantly fighting an uphill battle just to improve their financial situation.
What would shift the dial on this, do you think? What do you consider to be the key next steps or enablers?
Intentional long-term commitments to change our current financial and support systems to make them equitable. Long-term diverse partnerships are critical. So for us, we've needed our partners like BNZ and Suncorp just to be able to provide the products that we do. The partners bring the specialist knowledge, infrastructure, huge reach, and often people and financial resource as well. We need the government to be on board to support long-term programs. And we need to recognise the value of the community services or not-for-profit industry. We've just got different ways of engaging with the community, and we're trusted, and we can have different relationships with our clients. Genuine relationships about what's right for them, and also advocating for them when things aren't working. The partnerships piece is it takes a lot of time and resourcing, even just to get sort of established and off the ground. And so honestly, most charities lack the capacity, unfortunately, to spend time exploring and developing ideas and innovations to make things better, even though most will have loads of ideas and innovations. Yeah.
Any final thoughts then on the state of sustainable finance in Aotearoa right now and what's needed to lift momentum in the year ahead?
So I think sustainable finance is a really critical long-term goal, but we're also dealing in the here and now, the day-to-day, and we're doing whatever we can as soon as we can towards financial inclusion, which is about appropriate products and access and equity. But everyone involved in the financial and care sectors has a part to play. And we need to just get started, I think. Don't look at the issues as too hard or too large or ones that need careful strategizing and planning, because to be honest, they'll only get worse as we delay taking action. So look at what you can do now and how you can commit to it in the longer term. Organisations have huge networks, digital tools, people, financial resources, all those things that it would take the community sector years to develop if they ever could. And so what organisations can contribute is likely to be a drop in the bucket for them, but will make a huge difference to New Zealand families who are really in need. And that's now and in the future.
Excellent. Thank you very much. It's Fleur Howard.